Hey guys, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So let me tell you that this PDF is downloadable and the questions that I have taken in this video can be of use for your upcoming SEBI examination. Also, this video is relevant for the RBI, NABARD and other kinds of banking examinations. So let's begin this video. So guys, the very first question that we have is, as per the Global Research on Antimicrobial Resistance report, South Asia witnessed dash deaths per 1 lakh population due to AMR. So guys, this report, which is short named as the GRAM report, it is the world's first comprehensive report on antimicrobial resistance, which was published in a very prominent journal, that is the Lancet. So I hope that you are aware of the Lancet journal that publishes many, many seminal reports on health and other related sectors. And this report would continue to dominate the world of the competitive examinations until or unless a new kind of report that is that much comprehensive as this report is comes out in the world, okay, by any other organization. So do prepare this report thoroughly and I am with you. I will be telling you how and what facts you should remember from this report. So as far as this report is concerned, it states that the sub-Saharan Africa and the South Asian region, both of these regions have witnessed the highest number of deaths due to the AMR, okay. Plus, these are the most affected regions from the antimicrobial resistance. So, what is antimicrobial resistance? So, antimicrobial resistance refers to the resistance that the microbes or the bacteria develops in comparison to the medicines. Okay, against the medicines, the kind of resistance that bacteria develops is antimicrobial resistance, which is becoming a leading cause of death. Even when we will go into the details of this report, you will see that the antimicrobial resistance is now emerging as a major cause of death, surpassing the HIV/AIDS. Okay, so it is as lethal as HIV/AIDS, or we can say more lethal, because it is leading to more deaths. Okay, directly causing more deaths as well as indirectly also it is causing deaths to the people. That all we will discuss when we will go into the details of this report. But let's first know what is the answer of this question. So the answer here is option C, 22. South Asian region has 22 deaths per 1 lakh population due to the AMR. Okay. Now, how much deaths did the sub-Saharan African region faced due to AMR? It is 24 per 1 lakh population. Okay. Guys, do remember the journal, The Lancet, which has published this. Now, look at this data. These many deaths have been recorded due to the AMR. 1.27 million. This is, guys, the estimated number. Okay. So these many deaths have been recorded due to the AMR in 2021 in comparison to 4.95 million deaths in 2019. Again, a very huge number. And why is this AMR developed in the body? Because we tend to take the prescriptions in a very immature manner. We do not complete the prescription prescribed by the doctor. We do not complete the course of the medicine. That's why by taking the half medicines, we make the bacteria inside our body resistant to that kind of medicine. So the world needs to wake up to the AMR, and like they have collaborated for the coronavirus, this is the emerging, we can say, issue for which the world needs to collaborate. Okay. Maybe a new kind of vaccine would be needed, or a new kind of medicine would be needed to tackle this increasing menace of AMR, antimicrobial resistance. Now, it has become a leading cause of death worldwide and is killing about 3,500 people every day. Okay, more people than HIV/AIDS or malaria would kill. So this is really a stalking fact, and you need to know this fact, remember this fact, because you can expect a question in your ESI. You can expect a question on this directly in your phase 1 current affairs, or you can expect a descriptive question on the increasing antimicrobial resistance or the diseases that are there in general, okay, in the wake of the COVID pandemic that we have just faced. And on the occasion of the release of this report also, examiner may ask you a descriptive question on this as well. Next is that this is a comprehensive report look at the number of countries and territories assessed by this report. 200 countries and territories have been assessed in this report. Next is that the study estimates deaths linked to 23 pathogens and 88 pathogen drug combination across 204 countries and territories in 2019. Okay, for some countries and territories, the data was not available directly. Therefore, they had to go and collect the data individually. Okay, that's why the number increased to 204 countries and territory. This statement states that the AMR deaths are directly linked to 23 pathogens and 88 pathogen medicine, okay, bacteria medicine and the combination of the bacteria. Because as I told you that AMR is developed because we take half of the medicine, and because of which the combination of the medicine and the bacteria makes the bacteria resistant to the medicine. Okay, so thus the total purpose of the medicine fails here. Okay, next is the most affected region, sub-Saharan Africa, 24 deaths, I have already told you. South Asia, 22 deaths per 1 lakh population, most important data, okay, from this report, do remember this thing. In high-income countries, the death rate is lower, a bit lower we can say, 13 deaths per 1 lakh population, and this AMR was indirectly associated with 56 deaths per 1 lakh population, okay. Directly, the leading cause of death due to AMR is limited to 13 deaths only. Okay, 13 deaths were there because of AMR directly. But indirectly, okay, the AMR has led to 56 deaths here. So this is what this statement is highlighting. You need to know this fact. Next, in the Western European region, which includes the UK, more than 51,000 people died as a direct result of AMR. This statement and the previous statement that I showed here, both of these statements are focused on the developed world, and they indicate that not only the developing world or the underdeveloped world is under the clasp of this AMR, developed world also needs to strengthen its health sector, and thus all the world needs to work together to tackle the menace of AMR and start innovating in this field. Okay, the last point, the author is Professor Chris Murray from the Institute of Health Metrics and Evaluation at the University of Washington, which is not a very important point here. So that was the report, guys. Now let's move on to another report from Niti Aayog, which is really important from your SEBI examination, okay. So, as per the Banking on Electric Vehicles in India report, banks and NBFCs in India have the potential to achieve an EV financing market size of dash by 2025. So, here guys, the right answer is option A, $5 billion. So, guys, let me tell you that this report has been released by Niti Aayog in collaboration with Rocky Mountain Institute and Rocky Mountain Institute's Indian branch, okay? So these three organizations collaboratively released this Banking on Electric Vehicle in India report. Now, what is the crux of this report? This report states that if the electric vehicle lending is put under the priority sector lending criteria by RBI, then it would definitely give a boost to the EV financing, and thus the people would be encouraged to adopt more and more electric vehicles, because you should be aware of this fact that EV vehicles are very costly at present. Okay, sometimes we are not able to purchase them with our own money, therefore we need to lend money from the banks, and in order to make this more affordable for the customers, this report states that the EV financing should be put under the priority sector lending by the RBI and the government. Okay, so that's the basic crux of this report. Apart from this, it states the potential market size of the EV financing market. By 2025, EV financing market, only the financing market of the electric vehicles, would reach $5 billion, and by 2030, it would reach $50 billion. Okay, tenfold jump in just 5 years. So this is the kind of growth potential that this sector has highlighted by this report. Do remember these two statements that are highlighted here. Okay. Moving ahead to the third question, which multilateral bank has announced to invest $150 million in the development of data centers through Capital Data Center Fund 2, part 2 basically. So guys, here the right answer is AIIB, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. First of all, before moving into the details, let me give you a brief introduction of this news itself. The Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank has for the first time announced to lend to the countries for setting up their own data centers. Now we all know how useful and important data is in today's time. Therefore, the countries are also investing in setting up their own data centers. India is also working towards localizing the data. Okay, but how will we localize if we won't have proper data centers? We won't have the infrastructure. So this is just an example. The India's one was just an example. So in order to give a boost to data localization by the countries, this AIIB has announced to give the funding to the countries to set up their own data centers. Now, that's the crux of this news. Apart from this, the thing that can confuse you in this entire news is this Capital Data Center Fund Part 2. You would think that AIIB is establishing this fund altogether, but it is not so, guys. It is already a established private equity fund, and through this fund basically the loan will be given to the countries. Okay, so that's the idea of collaboration between AIIB and this fund. So do remember these two points and won't get confused here. Okay, so this Capital Data Center Fund Part 2 is a private equity fund managed by the Alpha Investment Partners Limited, and it is AIIB's first data center project. AIIB is based in Beijing. Do keep this point in your mind also. And the $150 million investment would basically be given to the countries in Asia, that too emerging Asia. Okay, the countries that need more funds in this arena would be given grant from AIIB or loan from AIIB. The next question that we have is, Kokborok is the official language of which state? So here the right answer is Tripura. Now guys, Kokborok Day was celebrated on January 19 by Tripura, and do remember that it is one of the official languages of the state of Tripura, because this can become a question in your examination. Apart from this, Bengali and English are the other languages of the state, other official languages of the state. Moving ahead, with which African country has India signed the Comprehensive Economic Cooperation and Partnership Agreement for the first time? Okay, basically, which has become the first country with which India has signed this agreement, which is a free trade agreement? So here the right answer is Mauritius. Okay, so what has happened? What is the news recently? Projects that are basically developed with Indian assistance in Mauritius have been inaugurated by the prime ministers of both the countries. Okay, that's why it was in the news. Now, what are the projects? First project is India assisted social housing project. Civil service college has been established in Mauritius. An 8 megawatt solar power project has been established in Mauritius. You should know this fact that International Solar Alliance is Mauritius is a part of ISA. Okay. Next is $190 million line of credit for the Metro Express project and other infrastructure project. Guys, do remember this point, because here a line of credit has been given. Next, an MOU has been signed for developing small development projects in Mauritius. So these were the projects that have been inaugurated or unveiled by the prime ministers of both the nations. Next important point here is the signing of this Comprehensive Economic Cooperation and Partnership Agreement. Guys, this signing has not taken place right now. In February 2021, this agreement was signed. But because we are talking about Mauritius, we should also know this fact that Mauritius was the first country in Africa with which India has signed this agreement. Okay, now this free trade agreement was signed the purpose of this agreement was to make Mauritius a hub for Indian investments. Okay, because obviously India is more developed in comparison to Mauritius. Therefore, by putting India's investment in Mauritius, both the countries would be in a win-win situation. Indian investment would get would reap more benefits in Mauritius, and at the same time, Mauritius economy will be developed. India has also extended in February 2021 a $100 million line of credit for purchasing the defense hardware by Mauritius. So this was particularly for the purpose of boosting the Mauritius defense. Here India does not have any kind of benefit from this line of credit. Okay, apart from this, India has also given a Dornier aircraft to Mauritius and a Dhruv light helicopter to Mauritius. So that's another work that India has done for Mauritius. So here guys, this video ends. I hope that you have liked the content provided by us. If you really like it, then do not forget to subscribe the channel, hit the bell notification. Also, you can like this video and share it among your friends. Thank you.